The heck?
The phone's ringing at 7:15 in the morning. We're not open for almost 45 minutes.
Ooh, look at the beautiful sunrise.
It's coming up earlier and earlier. I'm going to have to start the video sooner if we're going to get the sunrise in the mornings. So thanks for tuning in. I'm Jimmy. We're making it work. I'm not sure what day you'll be watching this video. On a Thursday is when it's going to come out, but the videos play all the time. You can catch them whenever you get a chance. So I hope you have a great day. That's what we're going to do. We're going to go in the shop. We're going to spend a whole day in the shop with me, Jimmy. So nothing good happened yesterday, really. I did about 4 hours. Played with my engine job, which is going to pay pretty well once it's done. We'll see what happens with it. Oh, a bunny rabbit. You want to go see him?
He's underneath the Cadillac. I don't know if I'll be able to crop it in that far. We'll go over and see how he's doing. Hey, Mr. Bunny Rabbit. I want to see you. How you doing? Oh, you don't want to play? That's one of those...
It's basically a wild rabbit. They got real short ears. It looks like a gigantic... mouse, but it's not.
Let's go ahead and finish opening the shop up and fire this thing up.
We'll have some fun. Stay tuned. What we have here is a 2013 Volkswagen Jetta.
Interesting. The, headliner's coming down. Man, this thing is a basket case. 10 years old. It's done. Customer states, my AC doesn't work. I just drove it in. Let me show you guys. It's got like a Christmas tree thing going on here. Oh, service. Little wrench light, blinky blink. Service. Check engine's on. Tire light's on. Airbag light's on. AC's not working. So we're going to hook the AC machine up. See if there's Freon in it. Have a quick look around for leaks if there isn't. With the check engine light on, who knows why it's on. There are many things that could keep that from letting the AC work. But the first step's to assume that's not the case and to go ahead and put the machine on there and see what we got. Then we'll know where to look. We also need to get it by a tint shop and get some of the tint fixed, because that would really bother me. Almost as much as all the upholstery and interior trim falling apart. But I can't row this person's boat. I can only row my own. Let's get under that hood.
Can't do that without popping the hood. Well, I don't want to put the AC machine on here with this, I don't know if you can see that service port. It's freaking filthy because there's no cap on it. And I don't want to blow that stuff into the system.
I got a feeling it's got a leaking condenser.
I'll show you why I'm thinking that.
That is not good. But they're pretty resilient. We'll see if there's Freon in it. Oh, it's got Freon in it. Like I said, condensers are pretty resilient. You can see how that thing's crushed and twisted. Let's fire it up and see what the pressures do.
Got a nice relaxed seating position. Man, that's nice.
I can reach the pedals, but reaching the steering wheel, can't reach the top. I can reach the bottom. That's how I drove it in. I try not to move the seats if I can avoid it. So let's go to 2. Okay, 3. You talked me into it.
Let's see what happens.
I'm gonna let it run a second. Uh-oh. I see the pressure moving when I hit the gas.
But it's not pulling it down.
That's a bad sign for the compressor. We'll go out and look a little closer. It's making a noise.
It's doing something.
But it's not doing enough, so... We'll turn it off and this will go higher. Let's see. That's off. We'll turn it back on. Yeah, so it's making a difference. I'm gonna hook the scanner up really quick, see if there's any codes might be related to the AC. See if it's a variable displacement compressor and it's trying to run it. And then we'll see what percentage it runs it at and that kind of thing. But I'm leaning pretty heavily towards the compressor. So let's grab the scanner real quick now.
He's noisy over there. Oh, that window doesn't work, apparently. Oh, there it goes.
I'm in diagnostic software clear, and I'm removing some of these other brands. got to make sure you don't remove something you're supposed to have in here. Anything that looks like a brand, I'm going to remove. And anything I'm not really sure what it is, I'm going to leave. Hope I'm doing the right thing. I guess it's going to leave me that annoying red. I hate those. On my phone, anytime it's on there, I just touch the app and then go back out so that it won't be there. Let me finish looking at this AC before I play with my scanner anymore. I'm going to get myself into trouble messing with that. I really need to sit down and spend some serious time sorting it out and doing it right. Today might be the day for it because it looks like there's just a lot of nonsense. They want me to work on a motorhome and they got this walk-in AC check. They can't get valve cover gaskets for the timing job. Joe's doing a water pump on that Ford Explorer and you got to take the timing cover off to do the water pump. It's like a 9-hour job. But they can't get valve cover gaskets. It's kind of strange. And I haven't heard anything on a turbo on the engine, so we're just rowing our boat and seeing if we can make something happen. We gotta turn this 12-hour week around. okay, this is working. We'll come back and we'll see what kind of codes we have. Well, that's not good. I'm gonna send Katie a report. I'll breeze through these codes real quick to see if any are AC related. Mostly looking in the HVAC module. If it can communicate, it'll tell me codes, HVAC specific codes. That'd be the most productive. But ECM codes may tell me as well, because it could think the engine's too hot, taking away coolant, taking away AC, that kind of thing. So this is gonna run a minute and have a lot of red boxes, and we'll come back. Go ahead and send Katie the report. Open now. Oh, we got faults in almost everything. Climate control module, two codes. We're going right to those. All the engine codes, who knows, you know, batteries, prior problems that were never cleared out, that kind of thing. Cooling fan control module, real common faults in these. Zone 123 misfire. Coil D primary circuit. Someone had connectors off with the engine running, testing it probably, who knows. Climate control, function limitation due to insufficient voltage. Climate control module, supply voltage. Interesting. I'm gonna note those codes down, take a look in the identifix and see what the wiring diagram looks like, where voltage might come from. Check it fuses, see what's going on with that. Could be looking for feedback from the compressor that's not functioning properly. Very possible too. So let's go do that, take a look at these codes, and we'll come back, see what we need to take a look at. All right, I cleared the DTCs out of the climate control module, see if that would change anything. The pressures still look real sketchy out there, if you can see that. I'll crop that in a little bit. Let's see, access permission. Oh, I don't want to do that. Actuation tests. Confirmed ignition is open position, engine is in state of extinction. Well, that's not going to work. Compressor shutoff code, engine speed, current, compressor load, compressor current actual, and specified. That's a big indicator. Let's take a look at that. We'll see. Let me see real quick if there's any other things we might be interested in. I'll put compressor speed in there too, just to see. Compressor shutoff code, 0. Engine speed, compressor current actual, specified 0.82, actual 0. So it thinks it has a broken wire, but it does do something. Compressor speed, so it sees the compressor's turning. So this is basically variable displacement and it's trying to operate it and doesn't get any feedback. So either there's a broken wire going to the displacement component of the compressor. Sometimes they have magnetic clutch and variable displacement. Sometimes they only have variable displacement and they just put the swash plate at 0 when they don't want any compressor action. I'm gonna go by this not working and I'm gonna get a wiring diagram to see where we need to check for that, and it's gonna take more time. This pays a half hour for the basic AC check. So basically anything more than checking for Freon and seeing how it's working, I've already gone past that, but I wanna get a good idea where we're gonna head if they wants to go further. And it's gonna probably need a compressor, but we gotta prove it out. You can't just put a compressor, might be $1,000 for this thing, I'm not sure. You can't just put one on there and see if it fixes it, right? So let's go back to the original thing of getting a wiring diagram and getting permission to go further. And we'll see what happens with this one. 2015 Kia Soul. I'll give you guys one guess what it's here for. Possible engine. I made you wait. I'm gonna look at this. See what I'll tell you guys about the key fobs, how everyone likes to close them all the time and stuff. And this one's broken pretty bad. So I guess to get it open now, I gotta force the key to open, and it's all coming apart. This is why I tell people, don't close it unless you're gonna put it in your pocket or something. Just leave it open. I know it's cool to flip it open and all that, but it's, these things are like $200 to $400 depending on the brand. So unless you, I guess there's aftermarket replacements for some, but. Uh-oh. Yeah, I heard it. Needs an engine. You guys hear it? So I'm gonna pull it around, get it in back here, take a look at the oil and stuff like that, see when the last time it might have been changed. I know some people will say it's under warranty from Kia. Well, they're not all under warranty. There's a time period of a few years. I forget if it's 2011 or so, or 2009 up to 2014 or something like that. I forget the exact time period, but we always run the VINs and see what kind of warranty it might have. Sometimes we'll contact Kia, have them run the VIN and let us know. Katie's husband works for Kia, so he jokes that instead of oil change stickers, they put engine change stickers in them. he said their oil changes their engine R&Rs. He's like, every time we do one, we put a sticker and it says next engine 7,500 miles. They actually came up here and put a four-cylinder engine in a Kia Sedona, I think it was. Rob and one of the guys that work at Kia came here and did one on the side for Donnie. Took him 3 hours, put an engine in the car to the two guys. So they've done so many of them. It would take me 10 or 12 hours, probably taking my time. But anyway, it's not a race. It's not a race. 107,300 miles. This one might be under warranty, actually. I think the warranty is like 120,000 or 150,000 miles. As long as it's within a certain year range, like I mentioned earlier. I'll put the scanner on it, see what kind of codes we got, and we'll take a look at the oil out there. I see some sparkles, but nothing terrible. Oh, there's more sparkles on that side. That's not a good sign. Let's see what it looks like in the oil cap. You see that silver in the oil? That's a bad sign. Let me at least get the codes and send Katie a report, but we'll have to check on her, see if it's warrantied or not. It's going to need an engine. So, you guys want to see the difference between a German car and an Asian car? You know, this thing basically needs an engine. You can hear the engine noises and the oil. I showed you a little bit of sparkly. The Volkswagen in there is in for an AC check. It had like 45 codes or something in it, 40 codes. This one might need an engine. It's got one code. Camshaft position sensor circuit. Bank one or single sensor. That is bad. So could be timing chain related with the, all the rattling noises, but it sounds like a lower end rod noise to me. That code could be set because if there is any metal in the engine moving around, it can get in the cam phasers and the solenoids and cause all kinds of problems. That'll make it set that code. I am going to look real quick just to make sure if that code could be related to the engine noise, and it doesn't need an engine. It may just need a cam phaser or something like that. But because of the metal sparkles in the oil, they're not too bad, but they are there. That's a bad sign for the motor. So, but we gotta make sure and verify. Like I said, when the compressor job, you can't jump into it without at least putting some effort into making sure you're on the right track and you're going to be doing the right thing. Guesses are no good. I am going to look at the cam timing right now and see what it says, if it says the cam timing's off right now while it's running, once I get this data up. All right, I got all my cam related data PIDs up. I also have, I brought up the ignition retard due to knock control for all four cylinders in case it hears a noise more in one cylinder than the other. It might help us learn what's going on with that. Exhaust cam actual and desired, intake cam actual and desired. So let's fire this thing up, let it run a minute, and all of a sudden these numbers will start to move around. Now it's showing me exhaust cam bank one actual moving around quite a bit, or the desired is not moving around. All right, codes are cleared. The tire light's on, but we need air in the tires. Cam phasing off the gas. Spiders on this car. It's been sitting a while. When it's the top of the motor, it'll sound slower and lighter, and when it's the bottom of the motor, it'll sound like actual speed and it'll be deeper and louder normally, like a rod bearing noise versus a camshaft actuator. It's going to be a different sound, similar, but you'll hear the mass of a rod or something like that compared to a cam phaser, which is a similar noise, but nowhere near as loud, as deep, or whatever, however you want to describe it. Everyone describes it a little differently, but. Nissan Rogue. 96,477 miles on this thing. It's gonna get a 5, about average. I don't think I rated the Kia Soul out there, and I was gonna give that one a 3. Just in case you guys are wondering, I don't like to leave you hanging like that, I apologize. We got a lot of little things coming in this morning, so I'm kind of running around working on like 5 cars at once, but not getting anywhere. Which is always fun. But usually it leads to work down the road, so that's just part of the process. So you guys that are in the business and work on cars for a living, you know what I'm talking about. Sometimes the first 3 days of the week, you're just checking things, and the end of the week, they want it all done. Anyway, she says the AC compressor is noisy. And I'm like, well, it's 96,000 miles. So it's like twice the life expectancy for a Nissan. At least it's not a Kia. It doesn't have an engine noise. It has a compressor noise. She said the air works great, but the compressor seems really noisy compared to what it should be. I'm like, oh, I wonder what it should be. And you know what? I'll know a lot more if I go out under the hood and we see what we hear.
Oh my God.
Horrifying. How could she drive it like that? Doesn't sound like anything terrible to me, really, all kidding aside. I hear a little bit of a belt noise. Could be coming from an alternator pulley when the compressor adds load. Sometimes those one-way clutch pulleys will make noise. Let's grab us a light and have a look. This is off. Compressor's on. Oh, that noise is kind of weird. That's definitely from a belt tensioner or pulley kind of thing, I think. And the compressor just adds load to it. Probably got it on max, super low fan speed. That forces the compressor to cycle more because it doesn't want the evaporator to freeze. So if you turn the fan speed up or take it off max, it's actually a little easier on the compressor. You turn this up a couple clicks and turn the fan speed up. Let's go out and see what that sounds like. It's still cycling. Interesting. I might need to go even higher on the fan or warmer on the temperature. Let me grab my stethoscope. It's very slight, but someone's listening under the hood with the engine running probably, I guess. I'm not sure. I'll grab the stethoscope. We'll see if we can at least see where that noise is coming from when it does happen. Seems like a few seconds after the compressor engages, the belt or a pulley or tension or rattling is.
That's gonna be a tough one.
All right, I let the temperature where it was. I turned the fan speed up some more and took it off recirc. I went to the next level. So now the compressor seems to stay running for a while. It'll probably still shut off, just not as often. The fan stays on longer. So you don't hear the noise of it engaging and disengaging. I think that's what she hears. And I do hear something going on, but nothing I can pinpoint yet. Like I said too, these alternator pulleys make a lot of noise, but when I heard it do something, I didn't hear it from the alternator. I don't know how much time they want to spend on this. It's a half hour check, so. We'll see how crazy they are about finding this noise and fixing it. It's definitely nothing to worry about. It's basically a normal noise for a 100,000 mile vehicle. I'm gonna pull that Kia engine. The customer thinks there's a hole in the block. It's so terrible. I'm gonna pull it on the drive-on rack here real quick and look underneath. I looked up that
PO340 cam timing code, and it just takes you to the sensor. It tells you to check the connector and the pins on the connector and stuff like that. It's not like a solenoid or a phaser code like I was originally thinking causing that code. It's claiming it wants you to do a flow chart on the sensor. and it doesn't reoccur. I clear it, it doesn't come back, even while the engine's making the noise. You let it warm up and hit the gas, you can hear like a rod firing. So
we'll mess with that one a little bit too.
We'll pull this one up.
Keys are on my cart. I'll show you guys something we can do on these. The noises from the engine are, they sound like the lower end inside the shop. It's quite a bit clearer than it is out in the grass outside. But what I can do is I can turn off the injector in one cylinder at a time till I get the noise to change. So I'll show you guys what I found. Cylinder one, first cylinder I tried, changed the noise drastically. It also changes the engine speed slightly, so that could be a factor too, but.
See, what I'm doing is I tell it to stop the injector. And the noise goes away. There's something going on with a rod in the bottom end. So we'll see what happens with this one. See if we send it to the dealer or we do an engine, but that's what it needs. That cam sensor code, probably something, someone was messing with it or who knows what, but it hasn't come back. So we'll see what happens. They're all connected, dude. Oh, oh, oh. Easy now. Easy now. Alright, I'm done with this one. Cream puff alert. 2008 Chevrolet Cobalt. One of the finest automobiles ever made. This is GM's version of a Chrysler Sebring. They're actually pretty inexpensive to repair, pretty easy to work on. Seats don't hold up well, the cushions are totally blown out. When you sit in the seat, I'm sitting in the seat like that. So this car, it's got pre-approved work on it from the oil change rack and 108,436 miles, about twice the life expectancy for your average Chevrolet Cobalt. We're gonna do two hub bearings, both fronts, and a left lower ball joint, which I think on these means a lower control arm. I'm not really sure. So let's get it up in the air and get started. The check engine light's also on, but they didn't ask about that. Oh, you want a love rating? Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know. My bad. It's actually for a 2008. I mean, other than the seat being blown out, a little bit of vacuuming, I'm going to say 6. It's in pretty decent shape for its age and all that. They even take care of it. The oil change isn't even due yet. Oh, I finally found the wheel lock key. I mean, it's not in here with all the gift cards. I looked in there first, but it was in the glove box. So we'll leave it open, make sure we slide it back in there. A lot of times, like I've mentioned in other videos, if you haven't seen them though, I'll leave it right there. Customer knows where it was put back, and they can put it where they want. They might not even remember where it was. It got custom wheels, so of course it got wheel locks, silly. That's a scary looking eagle on there, especially if your wallet's nearby. Halo brakes. Doing a hub bearing and we're doing a ball joint on this side. So you gotta take the brakes out of the way. But like I said earlier, these things are so easy to work on. It's kind of crazy. Luckily the calipers are light because my orange heavy duty ones are on that engine job. Just hook them in backwards so that the top hook's forward. Gotta open that up. That's why I have two sets of them, because first of all, sometimes you got a job hanging. And second of all, the light duty ones, you can tweak them and stuff to get them to fit weird things. Rotor, get off of there. Well, that is not good. This thing must have had some time up north with you guys. You guys from up north, you know who I'm talking to. If you're not from up north, it's not your fault. It's not that bad, really. I do have a gigantic 10-pound slide hammer if it gives me too much trouble. And I got torches, so we'll sort it out. Can't slide that hub bearing out of there without sliding that axle out of there. We're about to do a warranty test on the old gear wrench adapter, because it's the only way I can fit a swivel in there is with using a 3/8 with an adapter. Ha, what's the problem? What is the problem, man? using this setup, I don't have to pull the axle completely out of the way. Uh-oh. I might even be able to use the regular half-inch swivel on this one. This is the gray pneumatic. I get a lot of gray pneumatic sockets. Have I mentioned that? Not sponsored. And the sway bar is really going to mess me up. Ah, come on. I got a plan. Call it a ratchet and a socket. I happen to have a SunX deep impact and a gear wrench 120 XP ratchet. We'll break this last bolt on the other side loose. Whack! Now that that's loose, it won't care if I have a little bit of angle on my socket. See, and I don't have to turn it out by hand. Pickle juicers, take a break. That's not, yeah. I just wanted to try and see. Let's get some persuasion implements, AKA hammers. Oh, you know what? We'll try the icon hammer. I happen to have one handy right here. Look at that bad Johnny. Don't worry, it's gone. I was just talking to someone on the channel in the comment section about dissimilar metals. It was interesting, they said that the Honda has those washers on it because it's an aluminum knuckle and a cast iron bracket. So Honda put those washers on there to stop corrosion, which is what this is. Dissimilar metals, cast iron, aluminum, and corrosion. Luckily, it's not as bad as it looked. I shouldn't have busted you guys' chops that live up north, I apologize. Got the Milwaukee Dremel tool with a little sideways flapper disc on it. Now, you don't want to machine it, but you do want to take away anything that could cause the new bearing to not sit correctly. That puts out a lot of smoke, so we're putting a mask on. That's nasty. Nobody wants to breathe that stuff. Looks like GM cut a relief here, either for an ABS wire or to make it so you can get it out of the knuckle. I'm guessing it's for an ABS wire. You're gonna get too carried away. If you have to remachine this thing and it's way out of whack, you really need to replace it to do it right. As long as this surface is good, that's what really matters. This surface centers it this way. This surface centers it up and down, and you don't want it so that it's irregular. It could loosen up and weird things like that, so. Oh, you guys are getting it all over your face. I should have given you a mask. I apologize. That's better. I could have given you guys a mask, but the problem is it would look like that. So I didn't want to make it so there was no point in filming it. I gotta get the ball joint too. Might as well do it with everything out of the way. All right, just a pinch bolt on the knuckle. But the ball joint is riveted to the lower control arm, so you got to cut the rivets off and then punch them out. Sometimes an air chisel will just knock the tops off underneath, and then you can use a punch on your chisel to push them out. I would have sold the arm myself. The inner bushing, the radial bushing, is showing a little bit of cracking and stuff, but I do what I'm told, you know what I'm saying? I didn't sell it. Sometimes you got to get a cutoff wheel. It's a little more exciting, but we'll see. Eyes and ears, people. All right, they're not gonna go that easy. Where'd I put that cutoff wheel at? Just got a little more serious. Take note that when I did put my fingers anywhere near the blade, it was always next to it. So if the blade kicks back, your finger's not here. You always want your fingers and important stuff off to the side, because it will kick back. Let's see if the chisel will do it now. Fixing it, get loud.
this one rivet is really happy where it's at. Thank you.
It's either that or you gotta remove two bolts, so.
Now you gotta punch them up out of your way. Why would you want to remove two bolts and miss all this fun? This has already been changed too, that boot's blue. So this arm's an aftermarket arm.
Look at that. And the ball joint's $18 less than the whole arm. For some reason the bolt is a 16 millimeter head instead of a 15 like this. Hard way to earn 0.9, but you do what you gotta do. Just a little bit of the tin, man. A little bit of persuasion. I know it threads in eventually. Just gotta keep trying. A little tin shield has to be put on there too, of course. Tight. Bolts are all tight. Just got to torque the axle nut and the wheels to get this thing on the ground. We're doing a wheel alignment too, but I think there's a car on that rack. We'll have to wait for that rack. We got a few minutes though, so we'll see. See how long it takes to get this back together and what's going on in them. Sure which holes it is. There's a lot of holes in this machine. Only one set fits. Oh, gravity check. That's good exercise. I don't mind it. I popped the center cap out of the wheel so I can torque the axle with a load on it. You can also have someone step on the brake for you or something, but everyone's busy. 155 on the axle nut. Probably not far from that already. Ha! Don't put your fingers in there. There it is. Oh, it doesn't have a VIN code. Oh, that's mad. Enter manually. Shit it. Gotta lock the brakes first. Can't just be going around yanking a wheel without locking the brake. That should do it. Get that wheel straight. Get that wheel locked. I'm gonna say here, more to the left. Let's fire this thing up. Toe's way out, and
a little too much caster, and the variation in camber is not good either. I'm going to set the toe and then we'll re-sweep the caster. That'll usually have a pretty good size impact on it, and we'll see how it looks after that. Smoothly.
There it is.
You want me to get to the next flat to work, I guess?
There you go.
Oh, I gotta do a few more of those.
See how that goes. A little hot still.
21. And a little snappy locking wrench.
I don't know what the correct name for that is. A squeeze wrench or something?
Isn't that something? That nut doesn't want to turn. It doesn't look that rusty.
But I got the warranty checker. No problem. Something's gonna give. All we gotta do is figure out what.
Now I think I'm locking it tight. One side's green at least. You get it hot, and I actually brush anti-seize on here. It kind of soaks the anti-seize in. If anyone's wondering what wrench that was that I used my snap-on breaker bar and my warranty checker on from JD Tico, it's a gear wrench, 21 millimeter. Now, everything's green but the left front caster. Make sure this is locked down. We'll sweep the caster again, see if having the toe closer makes it any better.
It'll be 2 weeks.
Well, there's no caster adjustment. That's gonna have to do. We'll see. We'll drive it down the road, see how it goes. These are usually pretty forgiving. Well, you know, as long as it's not going to the right, caster doesn't cause tire wear, it causes pulling, and it affects steering effort and things like that. But see how it drives, and then we'll see what's next. Coolant hoses tend to not like oil products, and oil hoses, although oil hoses are more resilient when it comes to them getting coolant off.
Oh, okay. So like they have specific use?
Yeah, the rubber, like that's why there's O-rings, like some are green. The green ones you can use in power steering and air conditioning, the black O-rings are for engines. So slightly different materials. Because the engine oil will fuck with the green ones.
Was it like the rubber or something?
Yeah. It softens, it makes it into mush. Because the chemicals are more harsh, so. 97 Mercedes. I just got back from lunch. They saved it for me. It's so nice. Customer says their low coolant light's on. It's going to be expensive. Or it's going to be something simple. One of the two. It's never in between. Well, shouldn't say that. It's almost never in between. True classic luxury. Behold. It's actually in pretty nice shape, actually. No kidding around. I'm going to say 6. If it wasn't for the trash in the back, I'd probably give it a 7. I'm pretty generous today. Feeling pretty good. 174,050 miles on this cream puff. This thing is ready for the classic car shows almost. It's a 97. It's almost as old as me. Check engine lights on. All right. I'll close it. Low coolant level's on. Washer fluid level's on. It runs a little rough. Engine electronics. Didn't ask about that. Just the coolant. He probably knows all about it, I'm guessing. Probably got several $3,000 estimates. Oh, that's very pleasant. Let's listen to some music and relax a minute. I can save this music to my audio files. All right, let's get into it. I'm just stalling. I really don't want to work on it, tell you the truth. I got to be honest with you guys. I know you guys are honest with me. I got to be honest with you. I do not want to work on this car, but I will work on it. I'll try to figure out what's wrong for the customer, and I'll try to see if I can make a decent living. I'm finally over the 20-hour mark, and I still got a whole day to go, so won't be too bad of a week. I think the worst week I've ever had is 26 hours, working 5 days. Normally, when it's that slow, I get to work on my project truck or something, get something done. But not happening this week. I'm busy, just not making any money.
What are you gonna do, man? Popping the hood. It's a German car, so you're popping the hood. This is a German car, Mercedes.
Let's get under there and see what's going on before we get ourselves in trouble. Well, you guys won't get in trouble. I will. Hope that one fits. Oh, it looks like it should. We're in business. Somebody's done a bunch of work on this thing. Got a new valve cover gasket, the water pump housing's all new. Someone's done some work. It looks like it may even have a new oil pan, got a new alternator. Let's see if we can find a leak or if it's just a little low. Well, might only seem like a couple of seconds to you guys, but about 15, 20 minutes I've been looking around trying to find a leak, and it's holding pressure pretty well. It does have some sketchy hood shocks. If you just touch the hood wrong, it closes on its own. So sometimes it doesn't stay up on its own, sometimes it does. There you go, it's perfect. Nothing wrong with that. I'm a little worried about my pressurizer dealio, so I don't want to. I think it's ATD makes this pressure test kit I'm using, by the way, but I definitely don't want to damage it. I have the hood land on it. I should get a hood prop, probably. But I'm a little discouraged. I don't see a leak. Maybe once they're off the alignment rack, I'll take a look underneath. I could set the lift here, but yeah, maybe I'll just do that. Just to see if I can spot something from underneath, even though it's holding pressure. I get down on one knee, it's dry underneath still. But there is a big drip pan under here, so let me lift it up. Don't be lazy, do it. Well, that's not good. Little tiny hint of green stuff. What's over there? There's nothing there except the side of the block. Uh-oh. That's, maybe those are remnants? There's been a lot of work done, it looks like, fairly recently. I'm gonna have to pull this cover down. Okay, 8mm. You guys probably can't see from over here. Even though the camera's 4 feet away, it looks like it's 12 feet when I do the editing.
And now, like you see this air pump? What is that underneath? It's just an air pump, see? Right now you guys are literally 4.5 inches from it. So I'll show you the length of my flashlight now. That's about a foot. All right? That's because the GoPros have a pretty wide angle. Lens, so makes it look further. Anyway, point being, I brought you over here because looks like someone spilled a little coolant at some point, who knows when. It's just like remnants on the cover. There's nothing above it wet or anything like that. The cross member's completely dry. I peeked in at the radiator underneath, it's dry. So I'm gonna say it probably just hasn't had a coolant check in a while. Maybe it sat and work was done a long time ago and it evaporation, or it never was topped up or something. I don't know.
I definitely don't see any traces of a leak. Could run it a bit and see if we see any coolant on the ground.
Well, I do have some good news.
The low coolant warning went out. I put about a quart of coolant in it, and it put the light out. Now it just says check engine. I don't see any coolant leaks. I'm gonna let it run a little while. I'll throw my scanner on it and see what codes are in that. It's a 97, so we'll get some OBD2 stuff from it, but they're generally not all that happy about the whole deal. His dash is, looks like his dash is starting to give it trouble. It's an indoor car. I mean, the interior wouldn't be this nice. We have 97 Mercedes customers that leave them outside, and this is all destroyed, the whole dash. Plastic's all falling off the bottom. See what kind of engine electronics codes we have.
We had to enter the VIN manually, and now it's up to 297 as of 397. Let's check.
That's a 7 of 96.
All right, we don't really have time for this dinosaur stuff. I'm just going to get codes from the ECM. Uh-oh. Oh, no. I'm going to have to go to OBD2. It's not going to let me. That's one of the things with the early European cars. No matter what scanner you use, you got to go get a special connector for that brand. And I have it. It's put away in a case somewhere. I'm not going to get it out unless I absolutely have to. That's just how it rolls. That's just how it rolls. It's going to take a while, and then it's going to get mad because I don't have it on the right connector and tell me I'm dumb. And I'm going to go to OBD2, and we'll do a generic scan to see what kind of codes we have.
It's a lot of time in his half-hour coolant leak checks. That's all right. Don't worry about it. That's fine. That's fine. It's part of the business. That's what we do. I do not want to end my diagnostic session. Yes, the VIN is right, and I'm not going there. So let's back it out, and I'll end my diagnostic session. Don't forget your VCI, and don't do your updates. Nope. Not doing it.
All right. Scan OBD2. Should let me use that connector. Be a little bit less data. No bi-directional control, except the limited controls in OBD2. It's a little more confusing to figure out. But there are a lot of things in there, you know, misfires and things you can look at. Mode 6, 53, you can see which cylinders are misfiring. It keeps a counter in there too, even if they're not setting codes. So all I want is the codes at this point. We're going to let it run through here. It's going to tell me what it can and can't do. It's trying to figure out which protocol it is, because there are several different OBD2 protocols. One of them will work, hopefully. We found something. Read fault codes. Oxygen sensor codes. All of them. No activity detected. So we know they're nothing to do with the cooling system. I'll send Katie this report. And I can't find any coolant leaks. It may have just been a long time since it was checked. It looks like someone's worked on it, but with some of these older vehicles, with low mileage, it's really hard to tell. That could have been 6 years ago, you know? And it's been sitting in the garage most of the time. I'm driven a few hundred miles, who knows? But all I can do is say what I see right now. And then we'll find out how long. If they want to leave it with us, we'll try driving a few times, maybe keeping it overnight, seeing if there's coolant on the ground in the morning, or if the coolant goes low again. Maybe it's burning a little coolant when you start it cold. It came to me hot already. He came in during lunch, and I was sitting here when I got back from lunch, ready for me to do it. So, all right, that's where we're going with this one. Report and see how long they want to leave this thing, and we can mess with it some more. We'll continue on it if they give us permission or they'd like us to. Usually both would have to happen.
Probably.
I just want the copyright-free music. All right, guys. Everyone's locked up and gone home. Thanks for watching today's video. I appreciate you watching. I hope you got something from it. Maybe enough to torque the like button or subscribe. I'll see you in the next video. You're awesome.